I'm Peter Brown from Tiny and Sons Glass. Tiny and Sons Glass was established in 1978 with my father and brother and I. We're at 575 Washington Street in Pembroke. We're certified and qualified to do all your windshield replacement and repair. Tiny and Sons Glass is a community-based business. We have 12 mobile vans that come to you. If the weather's bad, you can come here to the shop. We have a nice waiting area, TV, Wi-Fi, kid-friendly, pet-friendly. We also can move about 15, 20 cars a day through the shop. Perfect for you when the weather's bad. So come on down to Tiny and Sons Glass if you need your windshield replaced or repaired. Tiny and Sons Glass, 1-888-64-TINIES. Just call. Thank you.
I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the Eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
Welcome to the Board of Selectmen's meeting, Monday, March 27th. And we'll begin our meeting with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and audio broadcast on Comcast Government Access Channel 15 and is being recorded for broadcast at future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded. We have a couple of announcements. Matthew, would you begin?
Yes, so we have a Hazardous Household Waste Collection Day, and this will be held at Pembroke Recycling Center on Saturday, April 15th from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Items which are acceptable and not acceptable are listed on the town website at www.pembroke-ma.gov. And lastly, you must be a town resident, have a current recycling sticker, and you cannot dispose of business or commercial hazardous waste.
Thank you. Bill, did you have an announcement? Why don't I jump ahead then, if you don't mind. I have a letter that I wanted to read. It's from John Ivan, who is a volunteer Eagle Scout advisor with Boy Scout Troop 43. And Jeremy Globin has qualified to and has recently been awarded the rank of Eagle Scout. And on Saturday, May 20th, from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m., there will be a recognition ceremony for his attaining that award at the Old Colony Sportsmen's Association. So again, congratulations to another Pembroke young man who has obtained the rank of Eagle Scout. We have a tremendous group of Boy Scouts in our town, and we're grateful that we have them. Thank you. Now, Bill, I'll turn it over to you.
I just have two things that I wanted to bring up. One is that the Pembroke Police, along with the Massachusetts Environmental Police and the Pembroke Police Boys Club, will be sponsoring a boating safety course, environmental police boating safety course. And the class will start on April 12th. It'll go to three Wednesday nights after that, the 19th, the 26th, and May 3rd, from 6 to 9 p.m. The course is certified through the state, and people 12 years and older will receive a certificate from the environmental police as long as they satisfactorily complete the course. So we've done a lot of these in the past, and Some people take these courses so that they can do out-of-state boating. There's a lot of New Hampshire, Maine, or whatever. You have to have a boating safety certificate in order to operate a boat in their state. So the class size is going to be limited. So you want to get your applications in early. It is going to be on the town website. We have three different telephone numbers to contact. One, you can get information from Officer Horvath from the Pembroke Police. You can get information from me at 781-389-4548. Or you can call the State Environmental Police and they'll give you the information. And actually, the applications, I do have a few of them here in case anybody's interested. But you can do the applications right online. So the sooner that you register, the better, because I'm sure that the class will probably fill up quick. The other thing that I wanted to announce is that I turned in my paperwork to the town the other day for the upcoming election, May 13th of this year, for a reappointment as selectman for another 3 years. My promise to the townspeople when I first started was that the only thing I could really promise you was that I would work hard. So currently I'm a chairman of the Water Wheel Committee. I serve on the Pembroke Fisheries Commission. I also serve on the North River Commission. I serve on the Central Plymouth County Water Commission Advisory Board. I serve on the Pembroke Cable Advisory Board and also the River Herring Network Steering Committee that covers Cape Cod and all of the lower part of Massachusetts. It has to do with herring. So looking forward to getting back into all these little committees. My wife thinks I'm kind of crazy, but I enjoy doing what I'm doing for the town, so would appreciate your vote. Thank you.
Okay. Hoffa?
Yeah, I concur with Bill. It's a it's an honor and a privilege to serve, and it's very gratifying to know that the people think enough of the job that you're doing that we had no opposition, and I appreciate that as well. I look forward to another 3 years, and I hope I'll be worthy of your vote in 3 years down the road. So, thank you.
Good. Thank you, Alpha. Do we have that young gentleman here?
I believe
here?
He's out in the hallway there.
Sabrina.
I think we have a young boy that wants to get appointed to the Junior Fisheries Commission. And I think he's got a little stage
here.
Right.
He is.
As he's going on camera.
Come in. You want to come right up front here, please? And we got a couple of seats here. So I'll turn it over to you, Bill.
Yes. Mr. Chairman and board members, we do have a young fellow with us here today. His name is Andrew Queenan. He lives on Wapatuck Street in Pembroke. And we received a request from his father and also from the superintendent of the fisheries in Pembroke, which Andrew has been working with us for the last year alongside of his father. We've been doing a lot of cleaning streams and cleaning up debris and things like that around the fisheries and the ponds. So it's been almost a year, and I also have a letter from the superintendent of fisheries approving his appointment, should the selectman so desire to appoint him. So he's we just started this junior fisheries program a little while ago, and he would be the second appointment.
Very good. Anybody have any questions they'd like to ask?
No, I just think it's terrific that a young guy would like to get involved in volunteering for the town, because we run on volunteers, and it's not always glamorous, but it takes, you know, some young people to, you know, give a little push to their friends and their classmates, and I think it's terrific that he wants to be involved, and I hope Bill moves the appointment tonight.
Good. Anyone else? Questions?
Well, I certainly agree with what Arthur and what Bill said, and I also have to add that anybody here who can teach you a lot about the environment, it's Mr. Madden.
He's quite knowledgeable already, by my standards, even at tech.
Wow. Perfect for the committee.
Yeah. Very good.
Anybody
else? Do we have a motion?
No more questions. I would move that we appoint Andrew Quinnan to the Junior Pembroke Fisheries Commission.
Second.
We have a motion from Bill and a second from Arthur. Any other conversation?
Would you like to say anything?
Not really.
You're a little shy for the camera tonight, are you?
Now we have a motion and a second. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, that's unanimous. Congratulations, young man.
I know he had a lot of mud on him the other day.
Thanks for helping out. Actions speak louder than words, so you don't have to say anything.
Do a good job.
He's better in the water.
It's 7:10. We're right on time, and the next item on the agenda is Mrs. Jennifer Mathias, who represents the Hill Bog Project update. And before we call on them, I'd just like to say a couple of things about the project for the public and for the folks that are here tonight. The property on Valley Street, known as Hill Bog, was purchased in 2010 by the Mathiases, who planned to restore the property into a working cranberry bog. Phase one of that project has been completed, and it was approved with conditions by the Board of Selectmen on October 25th, 2010, under the terms of the U.S. Department of Agriculture's Natural Resources Conservation Service. Phase two was approved by the Board of Selectmen on September 23rd, 2013, under similar conditions as was phase one. The police chief and the fire chief have inspected the property during this period, as well as the conservation agent, and they found that the work being done was in order. The town administrator and myself have visited the property. And so we are here tonight with Mr. Skip Landers to update the board on the status of the project and the plans to develop the property going forward. I also recognize that we have some residents of Valley Street here in attendance, and I'm sure they're concerned about the truck traffic and the length of time that is needed to complete the project. So after we hear from Mr. Landers and any questions from the Board of Selectmen, I will recognize anyone here who's in attendance if they would like to speak on this issue. So I'd like at this time introduce Mr. Landers.
No, you can introduce Ed Angley.
Ed Angley, thank you very much for the correction.
I'm an attorney from Plymouth.
Okay.
And, I represent Jen. I represented her husband before that. And I've known the family for quite a long time.
Okay.
And I have Mr. Landers, Skip Landers, with me, and Jennifer Mathias. you did a good summary of what's going on. I'm sure you'd like to know how long is it going to be. And
yes.
I'm going to defer to Mr. Landers because he's doing the bog reconstruction work. But I would estimate 3 to 5 years because of environmental issues, limited number of trucks that can be moved. You've got 5 days a week, weekdays, Saturday only, and with the permission of the Selectmen for some particular emergency or need. I don't think we've been to you for that so far. And we have 7:30 to 4:30 and a limit of, I think it's 35 round trip truck trips, which of course limits how much material you can move. Currently, I'm not in the excavating business, but we've been doing stump removal, cleaning and channeling of surface water flows, minor excavation, stockpiling of material. We've got mineral soils, we've got organic soils, we've got there's a channel that goes through, you've got ponds, and we have to be careful. We've had some difficulties with weather, a lot of water. They have to then make sure the water interferes with doing the work. But you have to also be environmentally sound and not allow the water to overflow banks, go into other streams. And that's what they've been doing all along. We'll do 6 street sweeping as needed, police details if needed. I think you'll see we put up signage telling anybody no left turn out of the site has to go right towards Route 53. We don't allow heavy trucks to turn left. We have warned all of the drivers to keep below the speed limit or lower on threat of being fired. And we have several blocks to renovate, and we're doing it as rapidly as we can with the resources that Mrs. Mathias has at her available to her. And they're not unlimited resources. It's a bog, Cranberry bog restoration, not a housing development. So there's only prospect of planting bogs. we're in the process of, it was interrupted obviously, of going to Ocean Spray to get some of the cranberry bogs that Jeff Mathias had released in Kingston, and having that ability to sell to Ocean Spray transferred over to Pembroke. The only thing is it's 8 acres and they'll only allow you to transfer half of that 4 acres, but that's a very complicated process, so we're doing that. So with that, if you have any questions of Mr. Landers, I'm going to defer to them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Landers, for coming in. I understand you're going to be our go-to person, if I can use that term.
You can yell at me when you have to.
I was hoping, as we had agreed to in the beginning, I had requested that we have 6-month updates to keep the Board of Selectmen informed as to how the project was going. And so we could use tonight as one of those updates. So I appreciate you going to explain things to us.
Originally, I had done phase one, and Jeff had handled all of the updates and everything, but I will pick up on that going forward. We started last fall with stumping and rubbing, and we started the excavation. We actually started removing earth to a project on Birch Street, which is going to be a fairly extensive project, housing over there, which is going to, a lot of the material might end up over on Birch Street, stay right in town. We're digging the current pond. I am an Ocean Spray grower myself. Landers is quite active in the cranberry business. And currently she dry picks the bogs, and to really make it profitable, the ideal situation is to wet pick. And that's where the reason for digging the pond, so she'll have ample water to wet pick the barn. So started. We've been out of there since January, pretty much due to the winter conditions. But we hope to get started back up probably next week if the weather maintains. 36 truckloads a day. It's a limited operation. That pretty much regulates how quickly the job is going to be done. Because that being said, if you did 36 truckloads a day and you completed the pond, it would take 4 or 5 years to do it because of the limited truckloads coming out of it. That's fine. You know, we have other locations that we work out of, and we're thankful and grateful to have this one to supplement some of our other locations. Going back 40 years, I've been in front of this board a few times, and we've performed and completed other earth removal projects, and have always cooperated and worked with the town of Pembroke, and we respect every bit of authority that this board has. So we're heavy earth movers and road contractors, and we're in the public limelight, and we hope to do a good job for you and the town.
My understanding was in phase one, you recreated a 10-foot deep section of land, which is now all full of water.
Yes.
Which is what you wanted to do.
Right, right.
And phase two, as I understand it, is a little more complicated. It's going to be a larger project.
It's a little larger.
A 20-foot depth.
Right. Yep.
And that, as I read, that's many thousands of tons of earth.
Yes.
Coming out of there.
Mm-hmm.
Question I have is, I thought there were four total phases in this project. Am I incorrect on that?
As far as excavating earth,
Well, I know we had phase one, it's done. Phase two, we're discussing.
Right.
Was there any other projects after this phase two?
Well, just the reconstruction of the Cranberry Bogs, pretty
okay.
much.
Which we broke into two phases. We broke into two phases, one set of bogs and then another set of bogs.
Okay.
Okay. So the reconstruction of the Cranberry Bogs, which will... oftentimes we'll strip the vines and their old vines and replant and get them to a more productive level, as they have some a pool, as Matthias says, what you call a pool rights, delivery rights to ocean spray, and that's the actually you're a stockholder and you get the best money in the cranberry market from a pool ocean spray rights. And she has bogs that are Ocean Spray A pool that are down behind the Independence Mall, and they're trying to transfer those rights up to Pembroke to make those A pool rights, which is where you want to be with if you're in the cranberry business.
I had one additional question, then I'll ask the board if they have any questions. You also mentioned that 40B project on Birch Street, and maybe taking some material on your property over to the Birch Street.
Yes.
Now, we had talked about building a road which would cut through so that the trucks would leave the bog, use this cut through and come out and all half a mile away from the 40B project.
Right.
Can you give me any information on the status of that?
We are actually, from our end, ready to go. We have a road right to the property line. The developer on the other end is handling any negotiations with the town or to come through that
okay.
Right out on Birch Street, and then Sealand and the developer have been handling that, so they're close, but they're being cautious as to coming across the town property. You know, what kind of liabilities do you have? What kind of liabilities does the town have? So we want to investigate that and make sure that we're doing the right thing. And there again, it's only 36 loads a day. So honestly, we'll take the 36 loads, glad to have it, and then we're importing it from other sites because it's not enough to supply the project. So which is unfortunate.
Yeah. So. Anyone on the board have any questions?
I do.
Yes, Dan.
So we know that you're excavating the bogs, phase one and phase two. When it comes time to reconstruct the cranberry bogs themselves, will you need to import any specific soils, or will you be using soils
from the site? Everything will be there. There may be some sand that gets typically involved in topping the final layer rock. So there would be some sand, like typically cranberry bogs every year, or every third year will get sanded in the wintertime. And the sand actually goes on top of the ice, or some people are barging it today. And when the ice melts, it filters down in between the vines and makes the vines stronger. And that's done every year, and it adds to the depth of the crop. So yes, sand will be as a constant part of cranberry. It will be imported.
Okay. Further question: the possibility of using the fill from your project to the housing project. Mm-hmm. If that's a real possibility and is an agreement that could be made between you and that developer, would it make sense for you or them to come before this board to ask for a request to increase the truckloads, which could speed up your project, mm-hmm. speed up that other project, and with the town cut-through that we have already negotiated with mm-hmm. them, it lessens the traffic, or at least the length of time a truck is on the road. So if there's something that you can work out, please think of that and come before us, because we might may look at it in a good light to speed up both projects.
Right. I will talk to Kevin Sealand and get his thoughts on it, and it would help the project and their project too.
Yeah, if you can do that and come before us, that way we can weigh the benefit of speeding up two projects, and of course we need to look at it for the health and welfare and safety of the residents who live in that area. Yeah. So.
Nobody likes trucks, and matter of fact, I went to one of these last week in Hanover, and going to another one next week in Plymouth, and it's a fight. So it's not something I like to do, but it's part of life. You know, we're building hospitals and schools and public works projects all over the place, and big trucks are involved. We'll speak to Mr. Sealand and the developer and see if they can help you out. And Landers is all on board with safety. We've got a full-time safety officer that is a problem. He'll be all over it. We don't want problems. We'll try to abide to any which way we can. So.
Any other questions or comments?
I think my questions are answered.
Yeah, I'm just curious with the number of cranberry bogs that we've seen in the last several years in Pembroke in particular, shutting down and one has been given an easement by the federal government to grow over the bogs and that kind of thing. What makes this such a special project that it's you know, it seems to be, you know, to the contrary of how everything else is going.
Right. Well, she has the eight pool rights, which puts the possibility of having it, as I'm saying, the eight pool delivery rights with Ocean Freight, which I am, you're actually a stockholder and you get enough money to make a living. And what makes it an important project is Jim Mathias doesn't want to give up on what her husband started. She wants to stay with it and kind of follow some of his dreams through. And that's, I knew Jeff, was a fine, upstanding man. And she wants to do this for herself and her family. And that's the level of importance that is the most important thing.
Okay.
Anyone else? Thank you very much, Mr. Landis.
Is there anyone in the audience?
Yes, I'm going to get to that. I know we have folks here from Valley Street. As I said in the beginning, if anyone has a question they'd like to ask the Board of Selectmen or Mr. Landis, I will recognize them at this point. Yes, sir. Give us your name, please.
My name is Bill Lynch. Live on Valley Street. I've just been hearing about this project going on and stuff, and phase one, phase two. But I never really know how many acres are up there, how many are being developed. Now all of a sudden we got this Bird Street and something going on over there with, you know, phase some sort of section 40 or something. Could you like me? I may be the only one in the room who doesn't know. But I don't know how many acres are up there, if they've already developed some. And once they do get rid of the fill that they're taking out of there, and they get the Cranberry. How many trucks will be taking the Cranberries out for, like, forever? I guess that would be. I'm just, you know, kind of curious to get an overview of what to expect. I live just a few houses down from the entrance to that property.
Okay, well, I can give you a little bit of an answer to your question, and then I'll ask Mr. Landis if he'd like to speak as well. That 40B project, which is on Birch Street, has been approved and it's already started. Now they're going to need a lot of fill to go in there, and some of that fill will be coming from the bog project, which is on Valley Street. Well, in order to keep as many trucks off of Birch and Valley as we possibly can, we've discovered a cut-through road that would join both streets. And if that could be used to take fill from the bog, come out of that road onto Birch Street, this 40B development is only a half a mile from the entrance to that road. So that would really shorten the distance trucks would have to go for that project. Now this other project we've been hearing, it's maybe 5 or 6 years, but I won't speak for them. So if you wanted to speak on the gentleman's question about the amount of time, the number of acreage.
There is over 100 acres here. Help me.
120 acres there. All going to be developed with Cranberry?
No.
Oh, okay.
No. Pretty much we're going to stay with what we have created as what our Cranberry Bogs is.
20.
There's about 20 acres there. And 20 acres will yield about 12 to 15 tractor trailer loads of berries in the picking season.
Okay.
No, that's not many. And it's, you don't even know they're there. They creep in and the machine that flood the bogs, you agitate them, they sweep them, corral them up, and the berries, and they go onto the trucks, and they're gone to the delivery station.
In October,
yeah. It's probably a three-day ordeal when that happens. A little history on the bog.
it was owned by John Hill years ago. It was his gravel pit. Years ago, John Hill. When I was a kid, we used to haul gravel out of there back to the... He had a crushing plant on Route 36, and they hauled out of there for years and years and years, took a left, went down to Route 36. And that, historically, was what happened there. And they were cranberry growers themselves, the Hill family.
Brian Hill.
And they actually, the family died off, and it got left as part of an estate, and it went downhill from there.
Jackie Gumbers.
Downhill. So, the cranberry operation is not something that creates a lot of disturbance. It's something a lot of people actually want in their backyard, you know?
Well, if you're going to use 20 acres of the 120, 140 acres, what's the rest? It's just going to stay natural,
Pretty much natural.
About three acres of upland for every acre of bog is the norm.
You got 20 acres, you need at least 60 to do the 20, and then a couple of ponds, another 10, 15 acres, you've eaten up a lot of your property.
Okay, up behind my house, there used to be wetlands. There used to be a big puddle of water, and if I went around the next street, I could look over and say, all of a sudden it disappeared. And someone says, oh, that's the work they're doing at the bar. Well, to tell you the truth, I don't want the water back. I get fewer mosquitoes this way. Yeah. But by the same token, I'm curious, how that happened.
I'm going to tell you, last year it did disappear. That whole area was bone dry. We had such a drought, and it disappeared. Yes, you're right.
Ponds,
the brook, everything
was
dried up.
It was the year before. It disappeared the year before. And you look across it, there was all this muck. You couldn't even walk through it. Yeah. And last year, when I would go over to the street, and it was like overgrown and stuff. It was like,
It dried up last year. The year before, there was no activity in there. We had finished that other pond, I think.
We have some other folks in the audience. Is there anyone else that would like to ask a question?
Hi.
Yes.
My name is Beth Bailey. I also live on Valley Street. And I do have several questions for several different people. And Mrs. Mathias, I grew up in the town of Bogs. I walked with my grandfather and my daughter. So I like Bogs. I was excited when I found out there were going to be Bogs used on our street. Having said that, I think it's quite misleading to say there are 36 round trips. You're not looking at the whole picture. That's 72 occurrences for that one project. And if the land is, you have trucks going by my house, and the entrance to the bogs is before my house. Okay? And my question for you, so anyway, that's misleading, and I wish you would say how many one-way appearances there are, because that impacts the roads. I've actually fallen on Valley Street while I'm walking my dogs because of the potholes. Okay? My other question for you, Mr. Landis, is don't you use contracted trucks, or do you? I shouldn't accuse you of it. Do you use contracted trucks that have no name, like small contractors? All your trucks have their names on it? Because there are a lot of, and this isn't just you, but there are a lot of dump trucks that come by that have no signage on them. Okay? And I do know that some people on the street even ask me, do they go into the bogs, do they come out of the bogs? I think your drivers are very respectful coming in and out of the bogs. They always take a right. They're very slow. I've spoken to one of the supervisors, a foreman down there, and he said he always watched them, and if we saw anything, to let him know. I have a problem with big trucks. I don't have a problem with the actions of your drivers, other than the drivers that do go by my home. Okay, so that's one issue. What about, you're saying 3 to 5 years? That's for the Birch Street project? Or is that to get the bogs up and running?
That's on the bog, the earth removal.
What about the logging issue? Is that a go-away issue? Is it an expected go-away issue? Or is that part of the bog ownership?
I'm sorry, what issue?
Logging.
Logging of
trees?
Phillips.
We've had a lot of logging trucks take trees in, come out with chips.
The logging issue, that is not my operation, and he's a local contractor that puts wood chips in there,
There are trees that go in as well, and those don't always come and leave from the 53 side.
Right, I cannot speak for.
That's a go-away issue at some point, because what happens is she gets a revenue out of the chips septic, and they haven't been doing so well because the power plants up north don't really want them. But it's helped pay the taxes, it's helped pay things that she needs to do, and as soon as she has the bog operating, that'll be gone.
I understand it's expensive to do this, I do realize that. It's just, there's so many logs down there, and if it is contributing to the upkeep of the bogs, that at some point could be changed into, it still works for us, why not go with it? That's what I'm concerned about. Again, because the trucks, it's not just your trucks, it's the trucks that cut through, and part of that's the Route 14 project, and some of it is that now on GPS, Valley Street, Birch Street, are the go-to streets to cut through, and traffic is very heavy most of the day. The traffic study that was done in September, we came here, did a traffic study in October. The report came out in February of 2016. Those trucks could be stopped and most people wouldn't notice what your trucks are doing because they're going the other way and they might split up or not. And that, I know it's also not every day. But bear in mind, again, 36 round trips is 72 appearances of 18-wheeler dump trucks. The road in front of my house is only 21 feet across. If two trucks are crossing each other, one has to stop so the other one can get by. And I did have a Pembroke policeman at my house when that happened. So it's more than just a bother. It's actually quite dangerous. Okay? So that's an issue with the bogs. The Hall Road. And this is mainly for the Selectmen. The Hall Road that's being built, I was told by someone at the Bogs that we would like to have had it used as another exit. I was told by the Selectmen's office that they weren't sure. I talked to the Conservation Commission, and they said it was a one-time use for this project, only the Birch Street project, because that's all that was requested. So my poor husband and I went out and drove from the entrance of the Bogs down valley to the Forest Street intersection, okay, which is 0.6 miles. There are 40 houses. We took a left on Forest to somewhere it turns into Pelham. Yeah, somewhere it turns into Pelham and now the entrance to Birch. Just those two pieces going down to Birch is another half mile and there are 31 houses. So that's a total of 71 houses for any trucks that come, and I know they're not doing it for the Birch Street project. I'm just trying to make a point here. That's 71 houses that any truck that comes out of that bog goes down valley and down Forest, okay? And I mean, you do get permission to do that.
We don't, we go right turn only.
Right, but there are times on Saturdays, there are a few Saturdays when those trucks have gone all day long.
Not my trucks.
Trucks coming out of the bogs and crisscrossing each other. And there's a note from a selectman saying that it was okayed.
Not my right? trucks.
So, coming out of, going from the playground out to the Forest Street or Pelham Street is 0.7 miles and there are 40 homes. So if you haven't okayed a permanent, and I'm not saying use that all the time, I'm saying that that Hall Road should be used as an additional exit for any trucks that are going up to 27 in Kingston. And my understanding now is it's a one project only Hall Road. And I would hope you would reconsider that. The 1.1 miles with 71 homes or the 0.7 miles with 40 homes. There are a lot of people there. We have a lot of new families on Valley Street. Every one of the homes that is sold in the last year has gone to a family with young children. Okay? So I would hope if you haven't been given permission to keep that Hall Road for potential use, not constant use, but potential use, I would hope it would be reconsidered.
Well, I think the position of the board on that Hall Road is it's going to make a dramatic impact on the number of houses that these trucks are going to go by when you look at the 40B project on Birch Street. But I think once we get that constructed so these trucks can use it, then we should keep it open.
Yes.
And any trucks coming out of the bog, no matter where they're going to the 40B or any other place, we could save a lot of aggravation. I'm aware of that.
Okay.
And when we did the truck study that you referred to, we had an extremely high count of trucks, and it is a cut-through street, there's no question. Now, we are in the process of asking the state to give us a truck exclusion on there, but we have to bear in mind the project that we're talking about here tonight would have to have, they'd have to be excluded from that.
Mm-hmm.
We also have to work with the town of Duxbury, because when they come out on 53, they're in Duxbury.
Yes.
So we're working on that.
When they get to the two ponds.
Right.
They're going into Duxbury.
Right. So we are in contact with the Duxbury Board of Selectmen, and it's just taken kind of a long time. So we will stay on that.
I hope so, because it's really causing quite a problem on Valley Street. There are ruts. It looks like we're in the state of Washington on a logging road. It really is quite bad. And I know the maintenance department comes down and they do patchwork. I hope they don't pave it. It would only be ruined. They patch in front of our driveway, the next rainstorm, the patch is gone and we have another pothole. It's just constant. And I understand, and I will say, I've gotten quite a few, well, where are the trucks supposed to go? What about the trucks? Well, High Street got an exclusion. That's why we have the problem we do. Trucks are going every which way, and maybe people are aggravated, but not in such a concentrated manner. You know, so I have seen a lot of your trucks come by, and I did complain, and I complained about A.E. Woods. I had quite a conversation with him. When I notice trucks speeding, and I don't sit in my front window and wait for them either, but if I see trucks speeding, I try to call the company, but I also report it to the police, which is why I have trucks that don't have any signage on them. And it's not just dump trucks either, it's a lot of the big box trucks, the big white box trucks. But as far as the bogs go, I think that's all I have for questions. And please keep in mind there are some really major issues. And please don't say 36 round trips. That's 72 appearances by that particular truck project alone. That leaves out all the other projects going on that other people are working on. Okay? So I would request you. Think of single trips.
Well, thank you for that information.
Thank you for letting me rant.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Lois Johnson, and I grew up on Valley Street, and we still own the home at 207. And I'd just like to point out that there are Valley Street, when people buy a home on Valley Street, the expectation is that it's a residential district, not that it's a commercial district. The expectation is that you shouldn't have to worry about a truck or multitudes of trucks, and the count of 36 trips a day doesn't include the logging trucks and the other activities that are occurring in the bog. But the condition of the road is for such a busy street, it's almost embarrassing to have people drive down the road. If you haven't been down Valley Street recently, you should take a trip and see what we're dealing with. I bicycle by there all the time, we walk there all the time. There are entire, so 18 inches away from the edge of the road, completely corroded with potholes. And there's no doubt that the trucks are impacting that, but the fact that the road is narrow to begin with, riddled with potholes, and we have the heavy truck traffic, I ask, would you want to live on that street? If you're curious, come by and sit in one of the neighborhoods that abuts our Valley Street and sip a cup of coffee and watch what happens there on a weekday and see for yourself. Drive down to the end where Duxbury meets. Duxbury has replaced most of their road at the pond. But Valley Street in Pembroke is just in terrible condition. It's narrow and the traffic is unacceptable. And it's a residential neighborhood. It's not a commercial neighborhood. And I understand that High Street's, you know, exception for trucking was granted some time back. We were unaware of that, but it's you know, it's not fair to the people of Valley Street. It's certainly not fair to the people of Valley Street. So please ask for your sympathy and to come by and see what we're dealing with.
Well, I'd just like to say I've been down your street many times. I can't argue with what you've said. It is in very bad condition. It's very narrow. The DPW director has said that it would probably cost $600,000, of which he doesn't have. So we're trying to address that, but that's another subject. But the money that it would take is going to be a real problem. But as you said, if you widen it and you do a nice job on it, people don't want to adhere 35 mile an hour speed limit.
It's not
30.
And that's another issue. At those ponds, the traffic, the speed limit was 35 miles an hour, and that was posted before any of those homes were built. There are at least a dozen homes coming up Valley Street that were built after that was posted. At our house, it's 30 because we're on a very tight curve. And if you look at that report that came out in February of 2016, none of the cars, the average speed was 44 miles an hour. All right? That's a real problem, especially when it's 21 feet across.
Well, our police chief is very much aware of this problem. He tries to have his offices there as best he can. He's got his other issues as well. But he's also written letters to a couple of trucking companies that we've identified, but there are some that don't have any name on there.
I know.
So the chief is very much aware of all this, and we're just going to have to keep after it.
I'll share with you a story. This is what it's like on Valley Street. I'm sorry, but this people think it's the Bogs, and in this case, it isn't. I went down to the causeway to take a picture of there were a lot of trucks on our street one day. I'm taking a picture of what it looks like when one of those big dump trucks come across that causeway. That driver turned around and followed me back to my car. Now, Valley Street's narrow, but there shouldn't be a big dump truck following me down the street either, should there?
No.
And when I called the police, he'd already reported me to the police as trying to stop him when he drove by. Okay? So, I mean, I can, it's a problem. It's a problem that needs to be addressed.
Tensions are high. We just want to live on a quiet street. We want to live on Valley Street without all of us having trucking. I think that's the general theme here. We're asking people to understand that we live in a residential neighborhood, not a commercial neighborhood, not a commercially zoned district.
You have a lady behind there.
Right.
My name is Patty Pluzzi. I live on Valley Street. Our street wasn't always beat up like it is now. We've lived there 12 years, and it was a beautiful neighborhood when we first moved in. A lot of building has gone on, and that's normal. But the road now, with all the traffic, the trucks, can't even get your mail. You try to reach into your mailbox. I said this the last meeting I came to. You take your life into your hands because the cars are flying. And they're right up the edge. That's because it's narrow. It's a country road. It's a neighborhood. And it's been changed. And I, for one, am very sad about it. Just wanted to share.
Now, the lady at the back.
Hi, my name is Louise Davis. I live on Valley Street as well. We're actually abutters of the Matthias family. I have three questions, and it's really regarding the Bog project in and of itself. My first question is, in listening tonight, it sounds like the assumption is, Jen, that you will be able, and you can tell me if I'm wrong, but the premise for this project is that you will be able to use the rights that you have in Kingston for Pembroke. Is that a safe assumption?
Hopefully, yeah.
So where are you in that process? Because I guess my question is, and I believe it was Mr. Lander said that's a very complicated process, where are you in that process? And what assurances do you have that you're actually going to get those rates? And if you don't, what is your plan B, I guess?
We're in the initial stages, because you have to keep the contract active. So I do not own the part of Bog and Kingston that they're on. So hopefully I can apply for a hardship transfer, and Ocean Spray has given what happened with Jeffrey. They have said that they would work with me and help me. So I guess it's a hopeful situation. I mean, there are other market's independent. It's just that they don't pay the way that Ocean Spray does. So there, but there are, I mean, we've gotten solicitations in the mail for people looking for cranberry bogs. So there are other avenues if Ocean Spray doesn't work.
And even if they don't pay at that rate, that's something that you
you have to do something with it. You're not going to, you know, you're going to want to have somebody, at least have somebody to sell it to.
So when do you plan on knowing when?
It's going to, you know, we're, like I said, we're just in the initial stages. I don't have a timeline because, and they just changed the regulations.
Okay. Well, then I guess that's my question, is if it doesn't work out with Ocean Spray, do you have other venues, other options? Okay. In terms of the project, I understand when I was learning about this, that this is the under the USDA purview. So I think what I'm trying to understand from a conservation standpoint, other regulations, other permits that might be needed, what is Pembroke, what is the town of Pembroke's involvement in monitoring the project to make sure there are no violations of conservation, changing of the landscape, changing watersheds? What is your role in this? Because I personally haven't seen any of the conservation gentleman, I forget his name right now. You know, I'm just wondering, when I ask, inquire within the town, it seems to be, oh, well, that's kind of the USDA's role, or they're really monitoring that. So I understand it's a federal project, but we do, you know, we are abutters, we all live in the town. What is the town's role in monitoring the progress, not only managing complaints of, you know, neighbors, but what is your role in monitoring the project, you know, from environmental factors, other factors, permitting? How are you monitoring the project?
Well, we have asked the police chief and the fire chief to go and do an inspection from a safety perspective. The fire department will look at certain things. The police department is interested in some of the things that have already come up today. Speeding vehicles, how many vehicles, are they going right when they exit? We also have had the conservation agent down there several times, and he was looking at the logging operation, and he was looking at how they were doing the work that they're currently doing. And we, this board has not gotten any reports back that would indicate there were any kind of a violation. And this board has asked them to keep us updated, and we picked a 6-month period, and that was really based on how quickly the project was moving along. I mean, we could ask for a 3-month, you know, if we thought that that was going to be helpful, but we think 6 months is adequate. But under the circumstances that have gone on for the last couple of years, some time has gone by. And so that's why that we're here tonight, to get caught up with what is going on. We don't really are able to enforce any current bylaws on this project. It all comes down to working with the Mathiases, and they have always been extremely cooperative, and we came up with a list of rules and regulations, and they have agreed to do that, and that was our best guess of how to proceed. And we figured if any issues came up, maybe we could meet with them and discuss making a change. So
might I suggest, perhaps, since this looks like it is going to be such a long-standing project, perhaps there's a representative from the town who can monitor the project and report back maybe every 6 months, or I'm not sure, because it does feel like it's a very large project. I mean, it's an enormous earth-moving project. There are a lot of trucks, there is a lot of noise. There's a lot of changes to the topography that it might allay some of our fears, and to make sure that we know that the town is actively aware of what's happening, and reporting to the townspeople on the progress. You know, because it is, we're talking 4 to 5 years, it sounds like, kind of on the conservative side. That is just a suggestion from someone.
Well, several of the residents of Valley Street have been in touch with me via email and talking about speeding issues, the number of trucks, where are the police, you know, things like that. So it isn't that some of these things don't come to our attention. So one of the reasons for having a meeting here tonight was to let's get started all over again here. And we've heard some good reports now from the folks that are doing the project. And we've actually heard from you folks, people that I haven't heard from before, in addition to the ones that have contacted me personally. So I would be open to that.
Well, I guess more than maybe getting a response from somebody or a negative complaint from somebody, you guys, because I think in other projects, maybe the projects that is happening on Bird Street, you're probably very involved. You know what's going on in those projects. You have people going out, checking on the project. There aren't a lot of people checking on the project, so to say. It's kind of a, you know, we know the Mathias family, they're a good family, we trust them, they're doing the right thing. So maybe just to give the townspeople assurances, more of a regular update on what's happening on the project, rather than just a personal email, maybe it's more, you know, more active communication. And that gets to my question about communications. I'm not familiar with the federal level project, but I know on other state projects, for example, there's new buildings going in on Valley Street, some new developments. As abutters, we got notification. We have never received a notification about this project. Now, we were very good friends with Jeff, so we had a lot of insight as to what has been going on, but since the circumstances, we don't really know what's going on. And I was wondering about notifications. Is the town required to notify abutters, or is that because this is a USDA project that you guys aren't really involved in it, and the notifications to neighbors and abutters?
Well, if we have a public meeting, of which this particular meeting is not a public meeting, we do have the requirement to notify abutters and advertise in the newspaper. And we do that all the time with other departments, planning board, and so forth. So I don't.
So was it an oversight that we did anybody get notification for the project or what was going on with the project?
No, I think it's an agricultural permit that, you know, that they have, and it's like a farming permit,
yeah.
Agricultural. They pretty much can do what they want to do. Down there, so by us monitoring what they're doing there now as it is, I think the town is taking a position to monitor everything there. We've contacted all of the departments in the town, and they've been working with us to try to make sure everything is right. So I like to look at something on a project, and you say, when you first see the project and everything is all torn apart, you know, it's like, oh man, I don't want to look at that the rest of my life, right? But just picture how beautiful it's going to be, you know, when it's all done. And you have all of these nice ponds and the nice grass and the cranberries and all that other stuff. It's going to be a really nice thing. And it's very unfortunate that you just happen to live there. But they have to complete it somehow.
Well, and, I do think everybody can yeah. appreciate it. It's a very long project. Yeah. And we're all very much in support of the Thais family.
And we may try to speed that up by allowing them to do, you know, a few more trucks down there, like one of the other selectmen said. That's a thought that we can look at that would make it not be so long, and, you know, and give them you know, a little bit more leeway to maybe get the project done a little bit earlier.
And I just want to expand a little bit on what these two folks have said. Is that, well, first of all, I think Lou might have misspoke. This is a public meeting. It's an open public meeting, but it's not a public hearing. And I think that's what he meant to say, a public hearing which would require notification. But communications is important, and that's something we could always strive to do better with. We, as a town, as a board, and other boards and departments in the town do check on this project and have. And we get that information, disseminating that information out to you folks on a more regular basis than we've been doing is a good thing. And we'll work on doing that and getting the information out to you. You won't necessarily receive notification in the mail of the information, but if you can get an email over to Sabrina, we can give you an email blast of recent events, so keep you informed. And if we don't get everybody on the first email blast, we'll just share it with your friends, because communication is important, and we are working on that. We are monitoring the process, and sometimes it's a failing of ours and other boards that we know so much about it. We expect that everyone else does. So, and that's a failing. We can do better with that, and I think we will.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Yeah, Bill Lynch again. I just did a couple of questions for Paul. If indeed the restrictions were raised, many trucks as you want to come out, how long would the project take?
Depending on what the traffic will be or how many trucks, it's a matter of, there's I think 390,000 cubic yards there, and if you do the math of 15, 25 yards a truck, when you're only doing 35 and you're working 9 months a year, it cuts in bad.
So you've never looked at, if you had unlimited opportunities, what you would do?
And then there's a matter of supply and demand. It's not everybody is standing on it.
So when you've got the whole road, is that going to increase the number of truckloads you can take out? Can you still be taking out?
I'm not sure on the logistics of the haul road, but there are probably fewer trucks with the haul road, fewer actual trucks, because they make more trips per day.
So how long would the project, I guess, I'm looking for like a timeline. Could the timeline be sped up by moving?
Probably cut it in half.
The thing is, we'll try to give you that information, but to do it off the top of my head is an impossible task.
It's supply and demand, too. I mean, is there a demand for this material every day? We know we have a project on Bird Street that is going to take a lot of material, but we hit the 36 loads per day and stopped, and we went to another pit, a pit in Tyler and one in Hanover. So theoretically, those trucks can go any of the roads because it's not coming from that pit.
No, I'm just curious if you had it, if you could unlimited, it would take like 2 years or 3 years. Well, I didn't know if you had done the math.
Well,
I also have a question for Mr. Stone. If you,
like I said, we've got 8 or 9 active pits going, and we don't like to wear a welcome out in one area. If I send 100 trucks in there, and you will wear your welcome out fast. So
I'm looking at 36 trucks for 5 years, maybe 72 trucks for 2 years. It may be worth it to get. We have a tooth on, just yank it out, get it over with.
Yeah.
I don't know. My neighbors are probably going to beat me later for that.
Incidentally, anybody that would like a personal guided tour by P.A. Landers, get in touch with me and I will bring you down there and show you what's happening.
I might just do that because you are very close to me, so I'd like to do that. But Mr. Stone, I'm curious, one other thing that you mentioned, everybody seems to agree that Valley Street is in deplorable shape. You said you've been over it yourself a number of times, and the Department of Public Works has admitted it's in bad shape, but they don't have the $600 it's going to take to fix it. Does that mean we never see a better street there? Or are we just like done for? Just go downhill from here? Or what's happening there? I mean, somewhere along the line, the street, if everybody agrees it needs to be fixed, we all pay taxes. Why can't we get it fixed?
Well, we could get it fixed.
Put the cops there at 44 miles an hour. They'll raise $600,000 in no time.
What we're doing is, and you know, I'm going to sound like a real politician here. We're doing the best we can with what we got. Okay, what we need is more money. And we have many projects. We have many projects, and they all require money. And that includes personnel as well as roads. And we're down to where we have no other place to go if we want to make things better. Then we have to look at taxes. Now, everything is always on the table. So we're in the process of looking at all these issues and problems. We have a balanced budget for next year, but we have no money. We have no money left. So we're going to continue to do the job that we're doing now for next year. But if we want to do anything better than we're doing now, we have to get more money. So we're looking at how can we increase our revenue. And everybody always says, well, you're going to ask for more taxes. Well, there are a few other things you can do. We're looking at all of them. And we have a committee that's in the process of doing that as we speak. I've been involved with Valley Street for 5 years. And it's really a shame to be. I'm as frustrated as you folks are. I know I don't live on Valley Street, but I'm as frustrated.
How nice is the street you live on? Nicely paved, nicely.
It is. It is.
It's, tell me the truth. Come on. Keep
it's,
let me know.
It's Oak Street.
It's Oak Street?
Oak Street.
Well, that is very well maintained.
A very nicely kept street.
Oh, I wonder why.
When I moved there 52 years ago, it was not paved. And there was nothing in the North River Plaza. There was no hospitals and apartment buildings. There was nothing. And now it's got to be just like Valley Street. Except the street. Except the street itself is in better shape than Valley Street is. I have to admit that. And but that's taken into consideration the traffic flow. But speaking of speeding up this project, that has been something that we have thought of doing, because a 5-year project seems like an awful long time, especially if conditions are not improved. But the only thing is, you speed it up, you got to double the trucks? I don't know. So I think keeping in touch with you folks, as was suggested by the lady in the rear, is a good idea, because if that is going to be considered, I don't think we should be making that decision. I think we should have part of that decision and the rest is yours. Because if I say, let's cut this project in half and end these folks' misery, am I ending the misery by doubling the trucks? I don't think so. So it's a difficult question.
Well, it's something that we could discuss if indeed we had some facts on what increasing would be. That was why I asked the question.
Right.
Because it would be something that, you know, you could look at, you know, you want to go 5 years like that. I mean, plus you're saying 5 years, that's from today. This already has been going on for several years already. So it's actually been quite lengthy, the project. And I'm sure that the owners wanted that, and they wanted to be making a profit out of it as soon as they can. So.
Well, a long time has gone by since we've addressed this issue, but I felt that we should address it the way we're doing it tonight. And the question was asked about how do the residents know when this is going to be discussed. Well, we always have an agenda. It's posted on the website. I don't know how you folks found out about it, to be honest with you. But I was told that we would have a group here tonight. And I'm pleased that you are here, because this has been going on for a long time, and we haven't had a face-to-face discussion about how can we fix some of these issues. So.
I just wanted to say a couple of quick things. That one thing we know for sure is that this project is going to continue until it's complete. So on the town side, we want to make sure that project gets complete for that property owner, but also serve the folks that live in town. So if there are any form of communication that we can do to better, and Ed, if we could reach out to the USDA and see if they have an update for us so that the next time we meet or the next informational message we get out to these folks includes any USDA correspondence. And if we can't find it, we'll reach out to the property owner.
We'll get it.
Great, thank you.
I just want to tell you, we can't find the farm plan. The farm plan, we think, is in the Atlantic Ocean. And I have to go over to Middleborough to the Farm Bureau and get the farm plan. And I will do that now, file it with you.
Sure, sure. Yeah, it's just a matter of having knowledge. Having knowledge of what's going on in the site for us so that we can disseminate it to the other folks. And the last thing I wanted to mention was that if we do think of any changes in trucking, increasing the number of trucks, I want to reiterate what Lou said because I agree with it. Any decision regarding increasing trucks has to come jointly from the Board of Selectmen and the people that live there. So we won't unilaterally make that decision. We'll definitely reach out to the community on that.
I think you'll find that if we're effective in getting the truck exclusion on that road, that's going to eliminate a lot of trucks that come on that road that using as a cut-through. So if that decreases and we increase the other trucks, so you might be looking at a shorter time. So there is... You know, when you look forward, I mean, it seems like that plan would work right if it comes together. So.
I just have another question of the bar owner. You said 3 to 5 years, and that's to remove Birch to the Birch Street project, correct?
The Birch Street project, I cannot tell you.
Or is that 3 to 5 years for the removal of the dirt?
The removal project, right.
So, in that 3 to 5 year time frame, is all the dirt that's expected to be removed, removed?
Yes.
Or 7 years down the road, is it, oh, there's a project we can sell dirt to, and that becomes another earth removal?
May I just say something? Our best estimate is 3 to 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
We have things like weather, blizzards, who knows what
sure,
happens.
Weather permit.
And
yeah.
You just say, it could be a little longer. We may be times that we don't operate for 6 months. So
right.
That hiatus gets tacked on at the end to finish off the project.
I wasn't really zeroing in on the time frame. I was really trying to see if that 3 to 5 year, the earth removal we're discussing tonight, is that the rest of the, is that the only earth removal expected?
At this time, to say that another bog might be created 7 years from now, it's a land
a project of this magnitude.
I'm sorry?
What did you say? I thought it was 250,000 cubic yards. You said quite a lot.
Right, and this project, yes.
Yeah.
But to say that...
Is that something that could be considered? Is that something that you have room to actually look at? the buffer zone that you said will be left? Is that something that can be used
to
remove
later? We don't know
I mean, what's going to happen at this time.
So hurrying this project along and doubling the trucks really might only lead us to the next project in a quicker way.
That would be up to the
but
owner.
But we don't know. Yes,
I'm
don't
not the
know.
Owner of the property.
It's not a no. It's a yeah. We don't know. Okay. Thank you. Thanks.
Yes, sir. Down the back.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Robert Chandler. It's my wife, Elise Davis, and my children, Will and Sophie, who we have to bring here tonight, from the babysitter, behaving themselves. Elise and I bought about a year and a half prior to Jeff, the Mathiases, came from East Boston, where we could share sugar with our neighbor from four stories high to get into the country and raise Will, who was less than one, and Sophie, who wasn't in the picture yet. And we love the old Gummers property we bought. It was the heart of the property. It was divided. And we ended up with the house, Jeff, with the Bogs. And there's nothing I would like to see more than that land be restored to its original purpose, which are Bogs. But again, as my wife suggested, just the doubt, just the not knowing, you know, is there a plan? Is there a rendition? Is there a drawing? Is there something we could see on paper that we see the end result, at least on how we picture it? Because what worries me is the scale. It just seems like a very large project. So you need water, I understand, for the wet harvest to farm cranberries, of which it seems like we're kind of teetering. Can we do it profitably under Ocean Spray, or do we have to go independent, which has put a lot of the local growers out of business? So if we're doing it, we're talking 20 acres. We don't know what the surface excavation is. How many acres is that you're excavating? You know, Mr. Landers?
The permit says 12 acres.
So 12 acres. Yeah. 12 acres, 20 feet deep. What is that, 240 acres worth of water for 20 acres worth of cranberries? It just seems very excessive, the amount of fill that's coming out of there. Now, you've used economical terms like supply and demand. I take it that this fill has a monetary value. And it just seems that to grow cranberries, we're taking a little more than we actually need. And again, I'm not in the cranberry business, but it just seems that we're talking about increasing the amount of trucks. Maybe we should be talking about decreasing the amount of fill. Again, I'm not in the cranberry business. It's just the math doesn't seem to add up to me for something that could or couldn't happen. So if there was a plan or something that we could get that would show us this is how we're going to follow through with the project, again, there is nothing I would like to see more than my kids riding bikes and enjoying cranberry bogs in the natural open space. But if it's just going to be an empty hollowed out pit with a bunch of solar panels around it, I've got zero interest.
Okay, any other questions we heard from, not heard from? Yes, Matthew.
Just following up on what the last gentleman just said, do you think you guys could provide some sort of plan for the townspeople?
Yes, he said there is a farm plan, but we don't, he said he had a copy. We believe it was in the possession of Jeffrey when the ship went down.
I'm going to give you a non-answer. I'll try the best I can do to come up with something.
All right.
You'll get something. I'm just not going to tell you that I'm going to hire a surveyor, an engineer, and put them out there. Cause
and Mr. Inge, we have something on file from the very early days in 2010. I'd be happy to show it to you and figure out which version of what it is.
Fine, because we'll do something. I'll get something. I don't know what it's going to be, but it'll be something.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Can we get a date or a timeline on the additional haul road out to High Street? I mean, out to Birch Street, so we would have a better understanding.
Now, what we're going to do with that is we're going to deal with the person that's building the 40B on Birch Street, the developer. It's his responsibility to make that road accessible as a cut-through. So we will start on that tomorrow.
That's town.
I hope so, because if we were to take more trucks, but half of them were going out on another street, right? Less of an argument, right? But right now,
they did the same number on our street,
right,
and added on to that road. That would be a plus,
and it would make everyone, you know, it'd speed the project. We wouldn't increase any, we wouldn't increase the numbers on Valley Street. Be easier, less gas, less damage to Birch Street as well for the trucks.
But Birch Street would be getting double the trucks, and I don't think there's anyone from Birch Street yet.
So could I just, for you folks that are intimate with these projects, you may already know, but some other folks may not, especially some of the people at home that are watching now. So these are two separate projects. So the Birch Street project is a Chapter 40B. That's the land, if you've ever seen the map, it's very, very wet, so they need a lot of fill. This project, this Cranberry Bog project, happens to be very close to it. So the Board of Selectmen have looked at it and worked with the developer to facilitate a roadway to go from their project over to the Birch Street project to shorten truck routes, because the Birch Street project is going to get the fill, and it could come from anywhere, because there's no roadway plan there. This project has a roadway plan. They can only take a right-hand turn out of the project, so many trucks a day. The Birch Street project doesn't have that. So what we're doing proactively as a board is trying to limit the truck traffic for the Birch Street project, and also, kill two birds with one stone, get their fill out of their project in the shortest route possible. So I just wanted to make sure that some folks may not have known that those are two separate projects.
I'm just concerned that it could take us long enough to get approval for that extra road, that the dirt's no longer needed over there.
No, the land is owned by the town of Pembroke, so we've already given permission to use that.
Right. Just, I'd just like to get that, conversation rolling so that we can get the trucks, some of the trucks off the valley
now. It's not the roadway issue as much as it is the Birch Street project being ready to accept the fill. And second to that, and Mr. Landers alluded to it briefly, but I'll touch on it again, is that when the Birch Street project does need the fill, they need it, and they need it now. And if he can only deliver 36 loads a day out of this project, they may not be enough to satisfy them. So they may need his dirt and other dirt from somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So if we can get all of it from that project to the Birch Street project with a half a mile truck route, we're going to look at that. We're going to look at that closely.
Quickly.
We will we'll take steps to find out where we are on the construction of that haul road tomorrow morning.
You can see it from Birch Street.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Just one more last question, just kind of as a follow-up question. So I just heard, from what you just said, that you guys don't have the farm plans. Under what plans, Mr. Landers, are you operating now for the excavation? Is that the original USDA plan? Under what plan are you?
My engineers have pretty much drawn out a 12-acre pond. That's all that's there, exposed, and we've staked it out, and make sure we're on the right area and everything, and we've staked it out and started at the low end, and we'll continue.
Okay. I'm sorry, one more question. Are you digging now in the place of the old reservoir? Is that the 12 acres you're discussing?
Yes.
All right.
And that reservoir was a piece of highland.
Yeah.
And the only way it was created was through a dike, a man-made dike with a weir. You take the boards out of the weir, and it empties out. So it's not like it. The reservoir, you can literally walk across the last so it's not like a real pond now. It's a piece of land that was, the reservoir was created, had trees and everything growing out of it, by diking it off 100 years ago when they built bogs. A lot of these bog situations were done before there were conservation commissions and all of that. They were just, you wanted to stop a brook, you put a weir box there.
My understanding is that the fish were removed and the water drained out. So is that the only place you're getting all this dirt?
The
old reservoir?
Yes. Yes. That's what the permit is.
Because that old reservoir was sufficient to support that bog when I was growing up. We watched Cranberries, we skated.
Never was. I knew the previous owners, never was.
Yeah, well, I remember the trucks coming out of there as kids, and they may not have been as prolific, but the bushes worked and we skated there, and the reservoir was enough to service the bog at the time. And I'm 50 years old and I grew up on Valley Street, so.
You don't look a day over 20
years. Yeah. I guess the point is, I'm like, as my neighbor here, I'm hard pressed to understand why so much dirt has to come out to service a bog that's the same size as the original footprint.
Well, they did a lot of dry picking back then.
Yeah.
They didn't, it wasn't wet pick. They didn't have the water.
So when you dig down the 20 feet, is that old reservoir that's now deeper but the same footprint.
Same footprint.
This is what you're saying.
Pretty much.
So it's going to be much deeper.
Right.
Is that going to refill with water?
Yes,
from the spring?
Absolutely.
And what, do you know what the expected time frame of that is?
Is what?
The expected time frame of refilling with water.
It will refill within the month. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your courtesy.
Thank you for coming in.
And we will get back to you. I didn't realize you didn't want it every 6 months. You'll get a written report from us in a timely fashion
okay.
of what's going on.
Yeah, we just wanted to keep on top of the, you know, the project. Thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming by.
Yeah. 7:30, we got the wage person on board for Debbie. I don't know if she left or what.
No, she's out in the hall.
Okay.
Haven't seen Laurie Cook, have you? From the Fork and the Royce? From the Chamber of Commerce?
No, I haven't seen her. Was she coming in to do a thing?
She was supposed to be, yeah.
Sabrina. Sabrina.
Oh yeah, sure. Right out in the hallway. Go ahead.
I guess Laurie Cook gave up. I don't blame her.
I didn't see her here. Did you see her?
No, I haven't seen her.
Yeah.
Okay, you're welcome.
Lou, they've been sitting on that agreement for a month and a half.
I read that part.
On what?
They've been sitting on that agreement for a month and a half.
About it.
Hi, Deborah.
I think they wanted a haul in the wintertime.
Yeah.
I think the new ones, they didn't want a haul.
Yeah.
They didn't want to use that road in the wintertime.
It hasn't got to really happen anymore.
Okay, wait a minute.
Afterwards.
So, Deborah Wall.
Yes, good evening.
The floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Thank you for letting me come to the Wage and Personnel. As you know, the library trustees put forward 2 articles for town meeting. I will talk about the easier of the first article was an article to provide for sick leave for our part-time employees. We have 12 part-time employees that work 19 hours, and they cannot go over 19 hours, so they get no benefits. And in 2015, which I'm sure you folks are aware, Massachusetts wrote a law that allowed, well, mandated that companies give sick leave to part-time employees. And of course the towns do not have to follow that, but we were requested by our staff to look into it, and then the trustees agreed to put this forward. So this article was very much fashioned after the state article, in that it has caps of sick leave. They can earn no more than 40 hours, they can't carry over more than 40 hours, and there's a 90-day wait. I think this is a fair motion for employees. Sick leave is, if you get sick and you're living on a part-time wage, it's extremely difficult to recoup from that. In the article, we did ask for a sum of money, which may or may not be necessary in the first year. The sum of money was more our estimate of risk. Financial risk. That number is probably a little higher than it would need to be, especially the first year, because people would have to accrue the time. But it was just like a ballpark figure that we had figured out. Actually, by our figures, staff we have in place now, by year 2, when they can actually start accruing close to the maximum, if they all took all of it, it would be about a $4,000 hit to us. Unlikely that all people would take all of it. But in our reality is when one of our part-time people call in sick, we most often have to replace them. They're the frontline staff. So it's not a situation where they work to sit for a day and they can do it the next day. We do need the staff in place. So we would have to replace them if they were out sick. And then we would be paying them too. So that is why we asked for the sum of money. I did talk to the town accountant and he's comfortable removing the sum of money and see how it plays out for the year. And we're open to that too, as long as if there is any, damage, if there is any detriment to the budget because of this, we would have some way to level off our budget for the year. But that's that article. Any questions about it?
Questions?
So I don't notice anything here about a requirement doctor's note.
No, well, not for one, not for like if they just call in sick one day.
Mm-hmm.
The state law is actually, I don't know, 4 pages long. I was really surprised when I picked up the state law. It's very hefty as far as very specific requirements for the companies, and we left out a lot of that. But in Pembroke now, as the rules are, if employees out for 3 days, that's when they need to bring in a note. So I am presuming that that would still hold true. If they were out more than 3 days, they would bring in a doctor's note.
Matthew?
So you say that the staff needs to be replaced when they're sick, but it's also my understanding that Pembroke High School students need to do roughly 40 hours of community service. Now, I myself actually did community service at the library when I was in high school. So have you ever considered utilizing high school students to replace sick members?
Absolutely not. Our staff goes through a fairly lengthy training. There's a lot they have to know to work the catalog, the checkout system, and they have to, by network policy, they have to be an employee to be able to check people in and out, because there are state privacy rules about what people check in and out of libraries. So it cannot be just any volunteer to check people in and out. But we do use, we're always happy to have the high school volunteers for a lot of other things, but not that. And even now, if someone calls in sick, because our budget is somewhat tight, we do consider if we can let it not get filled. So sometimes we don't, or sometimes a full-time person will do it, but that takes away from a full-time position. That work's not getting done. But no, we cannot have a volunteer do it.
Okay, I just wondered.
Good.
Okay,
next.
All right, that one's done. All right, second article. Actually, let me start with a little bit of a handout.
Thanks, Deb.
What I'm handing you, fellas, I will explain in a minute.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Finger records, please. Okay. So this article is an extension of something we've been trying to accomplish for several years. The article put forward is to amend Schedule A to allow for our currently part-time adult services / reference librarian to become full-time. She is one of those 19-hour staffers that I've been mentioning earlier. And a little history. When the building was built in 1998, they planned for a reference librarian. They built a reference librarian office, they built a reference librarian desk, and there was no reference librarian. When I got there in 2001, I inquired about it, and in 2002 we had a huge budget problem, so that went on the side. I asked about it for a few years, could never get it into the budget, put an article forward in 2012. It was approved at town meeting, and not funded. So then the following year, with discussion with Selectmen and Advisory and Ed, the suggestion was we go forward with a part-time position, and we did, knowing that it was a half a loaf better than none situation, and that at least it gave us the services of a reference adult librarian, at least even part-time. The challenge which I recognized then, was it's very difficult to maintain professional librarian staff on a part-time basis, because when you're paying for a master's degree, you really need a full-time salary and you need benefits. That has unfortunately played out. Our first librarian lasted a year. The second one lasted 9 months, almost 10. The wonderful librarian who's with us now has been with us just about a year and a half. And I would not be even slightly exaggerating if I didn't tell you that she is being shopped by other libraries, because most libraries around us have full-time reference librarians, and they know what she's accomplished, and she's very personable, and they've been asking her to apply for their jobs when it opens. So far, she is trying to hold out. She really loves it in Pembroke, and she is doing a fabulous job, which addresses what I just handed out to you. The colorful page is the number of events and programs that have been happening over the years in Pembroke since 2011, and the chart on the bottom. And the most notable is that, as I said, our current librarian's been there for all of 2016. Adult programs, which was mostly me for most of the time, went up from 52 events a year to 124. That's her working very hard at 19 hours. And me, still, of course, but. And attendance this past year went up from 406 in 2015 to 1,300 people. She has a cookbook club that has 15 people. She has a book club that has grown to like 15 people every month. She has started all of these ongoing programs. We have speakers that come with great turnout. We're also been doing a lot more, well, trying to be doing a lot more teaching of classes, Excel classes, Word classes. She just offered a class on Saturday on Word. And all of those have wait lists. And as soon as we have one, we have a request for another class. They asked for Excel Part 2. And I mean, it's a huge demand to be able to offer that. And she does an amazing, amazing job. And on top of that, she does research for people. She sits down with them and does one-on-one when they need help with their iPads. She helps them post their resumes, all of that. And it's a wonderful asset having her. And we really need her to be full-time. The other page is I had asked her for a rundown, and this ended in December because I actually did it with the original budget presentation. This gives a sense of what she does on any given day or any given week. And then she added at the back some things that she would like to accomplish if she were there full time. And in this calendar year, we're going to be working on our strategic plan, which is starting it now. And she's going to be instrumental in helping with that. And I think I can pretty much guarantee that through that is going to show just a more demand for classes, a more demand for events and participation in those. And without a full-time librarian, it's very much hard. It's very hard to accomplish. Now, all that being said, I realize Wage and Personnel has talked to the selectmen, and they know that budget's tight. So I am very strongly making a case for this, knowing that now is not a good year, but also understanding that in all likelihood, I'll be looking for a new librarian. And that's unfortunate, because what that does, clearly, is it creates a gap in service. And any new staff person, any librarian, you take a little while to learn the job and get up to speed and get to know the community. So there's just a gap in service when those things happen. It's unfortunate. I don't want to lose her. We don't want to lose her. But, you know, I know the reality of things. But I really just wanted to make this case, and I want to really make it as clear as I can to everyone that this is an important thing. This is a need. It's not us, you know, saying, oh, this is something we really should have someday. It's something that was identified immediately and that I've been fighting for all along. And and the longer that she's been here, particularly, she's done a phenomenal job. She's really shown what the job could be, and to have it full-time would be the best service we could possibly provide to the residents of the town. Yeah. Any questions?
Any questions for Deborah?
No?
Yes.
Sorry.
That's
you
okay.
Can go.
No, go ahead.
What is her master's degree in?
Library science.
Library science. And from where?
Simmons.
Simmons College.
Okay. As is mine. Yeah. Generally around here, you, well, no, my children's librarian actually got her, my youth services librarian, got her degree in Pennsylvania. But around here, generally, librarians either get their degrees either at Simmons or sometimes at URI.
All right, and one other question is, you have these speaker events on this calendar, you say you have 7 of them, is that for that whole year, you had 7 speaker events with attendance of 106?
Speakers, maybe, let's see. Those would have been the ones she planned. There were some that I planned that she did not count. These are what she absolutely had hands on doing. I think she didn't count, yeah, looking at this, I can tell you, she didn't count ones that I brought in. So those are what she did. So
okay.
I would say for a year, we try to have at least one a month. I mean, sometimes there's a gap,
yeah.
But because speakers cost money, that's the honest truth too. Most speakers expect a speaking fee. If we can get them really inexpensively or free, that's great. But a lot of the time they want $200, $300, $400. And that has to get funded. Mostly it gets funded by the Friends group.
Yeah.
So we are slightly limited in that. Like, I can't always do a program every month because my youth services librarian wants to do programs too, so, and bring in speakers for the kids too. So we're always sort of trying to balance that. But yeah, she didn't count my programs I did. So those are the ones that she planned.
Okay, thank you.
So Deb, yeah, I was just thinking of trying to wrap my head around what the mindset of the town meeting would be and the questions that have come, so so we can be prepared for it. So one of the questions that people may have is, you show the steps, steps 1, 2, and 3, and someone's going to ask, is this a raise in the steps to begin with? Someone on town meeting floor may ask that question.
No, this is when I built that, it's based on the existing scale that she's in now.
Mm-hmm.
So her hourly would, strictly speaking, be the same. Well, you know, for step one, she would go to step two. Yeah. Yes,
right.
But no, that's, we didn't build a raise into it. Because it's still her. It's still a position that requires a master's degree. So, no, there was no raise inherently built into that.
Right, and that's questions that someone may have, just reading this on the face of it. When people come to town meeting, a lot of times they turn the page, okay, what's the next article? It's the first time they've seen this, so they'll have a quick question on it. So just for the, I think I understand, bottom line is that you want to take a part-time person or make her a full-time person.
Correct.
And that's the information that needs to get out there. And it's you could read that in the summary, but a couple of people might get lost, so we just want to make sure that message gets out there right off the bat.
Absolutely. And you're absolutely right, because when I've done, people do get caught up in that. They feel like you're adding a position, and we're absolutely not. This is not an additional body. This is just a body there longer during the day and actually available to people more often. Right, and they would catch that. I just felt it necessary to write a little of that narrative so people would have a sense of the history that that we've been trying to accomplish this for some time.
Right. And so you may have said it, but I might have missed it. What are her hours now?
She works 19 hours now. So
no, I mean, I should say the days. Does she come in every
she
day part time?
She does not work Friday.
Okay.
She's not here Friday, Saturday, or Sunday. Except when she wants to do a class, like this past Saturday, she did not work Thursday. She didn't work Monday, she worked Saturday. But usually she's there Monday through Thursday.
Okay, thanks.
And 2 nights a week, and 2 mornings. Or 1 morning, 1 afternoon, 2 nights. So it allows a broad offering for people to be able to come in and see her.
So if you did transition her to full-time, do you have an idea of what her schedule would be?
She would probably, she would probably do it still at least two nights. I'd probably try to get her in on weekends at some point, like probably Saturdays, because we don't have, for instance, an afternoon. We don't have a librarian most of the time on Saturday, so I'd probably get her on Saturday. And that, as I said, at least a couple of nights.
Would her compensation be hourly or salaried?
Salaried. Yeah, she'd be full-time, and then full-time for our regular staff, not a custodian, but our regular staff is 39 and a half. 37 and a half. Jeez, 37 and a half.
Hours a week.
Hours a week, right.
Anyone else? Thank you very much for the explanation.
You're very welcome. All right. Thank you so very much, fellas. Have a good night.
You too.
Thank you, Deborah. We have a request from Deirdre Hussey to use the town roads to conduct their annual nonprofit road walk and race fundraiser, the Huss Dog Jog. It starts and ends at the Pembroke soccer fields and is contained on Learning Lane. The school department has scheduled the event and the police department has approved it. It's on Saturday, July 15th. 6 a.m. is the registration and it'll end at 1 p.m. Are there any questions or is there a motion?
I would move we honor the request and grant the Hussey family the permit for Learning Lane on July 15th of 2017 with the approval of the police department.
Second.
Motion by Arthur and second by Bill. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, it's unanimous. Thank you. Ed, do we want to go forward with the user?
Yeah, I was wondering if the board had a chance when I gave this to the board a couple of weeks ago to look at the abatements for the trash program. Probably like spend a little bit of time on that, and you know, we got several other things we need to deal with, including an executive session in which the board has to take a vote. So if you wouldn't mind, don't lose this and keep it, you know, for next week. And I would ask that the board table this for 1 week and until we can spend some time talking about this.
Move to table for 1 week.
Motion by Arthur to table for a week, seconded by Bill. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. It's unanimous. Thank you, Ed. Now we're going to, in order to stay on our schedule, to have the warrant ready with all the articles, with our vote on the articles, we have a few in front of us that we have already talked about as being more or less a routine or housekeeping items. We'd like to agree on the actions that this board will take on these articles. Article 1 is to accept the annual report. 7 is a stabilization fund transfer, but we want to put that off, take no action in the spring, and take that up in the fall. Article 8 is to allow the Board of Selectmen to apply and receive grants. Authorize revolving funds, that's Article 9. Article 10, enter contracts with Mass DOT. Article 12, $5,000 for the South Shore action. Article 17 is a bylaw amendment, it's the housekeeping article. And Article 20 is a street acceptance, which we addressed last week, Equestrian Drive and Pheasant Lane. In the that is in the annual. So we have suggested actions of favorable for 1, 8, 9, 10, 12, 17, and 20. So I'll there's not any questions from the board?
Question.
Yes, Dan.
Ed, Article 9, revolving accounts.
Correct.
Have there been any added revolving accounts, and have there been any revolving account monies that have expanded by any significant
amount? I don't believe the answer to both your questions is no. I don't believe that there's any additional money that's been added to any of those.
Number 14 is the civilian fingerprint printing revenue.
Oh, that's right. That was something I was just...
To fund the program. That was just at the fall town meeting. That's the only one.
That's the only one. That's correct.
So the revenue that comes in for that can support the program.
That was the only question I had.
Okay. Any other questions? Hearing none, can we have a motion to take favorable action on those articles?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. Turning to the special within the annual, we have Article 5, which is a transfer of $360,000 from the water surplus fund for the Route 14 project water needs. Article 6, and they're recommending favorable action. Article 6 is to accept 140 Center Street from the VFW, recommended favorable action. Article 7 is to allow the Board of Selectmen a fee simple interest in B2-3115, which is allowing the board to auction the Bartlett Street property. Those three articles are recommended favorable action. Are there any questions or a motion?
I would move favorable action on Articles 5, 6, and 7 for the special within the annual.
Second. Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. Any questions? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. It's unanimous. Now, I seem to have skipped by a discussion on the early retired employee health care and non-union contributions. Raising the contributions currently being paid to 25% over a three-year period. I think we were expecting to hear from our treasurer, Kathleen. And the decision is? Is she coming in?
Okay.
No one left in the hall.
All right. What we have is we have two categories of individuals that are under the authority of the Board of Selectmen. One are non-union employees who are currently paying 22%, and the recommendation is for the non-union employees to be raised 1% each year until they reach 25% on July the 1st, 2019. And the second category is for employees that retire early, that are not eligible for Medicare, and that are still on the town's payroll from a retirement standpoint, and also on the town's rolls as health insurance. These early retirees, as we call them, only contribute 15%. And the plan is for them to be increased over a three-year period to 25%. And there's 22 of these employees out of the 660 that are total on the town's health insurance rolls.
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
I may be ineligible to vote on one of these, and because my wife is because I'm on Medicare,
mm-hmm.
and she's on, what plan would she be on here? It definitely wouldn't be non-union employee because she's not an employee. But
right now, is she on the town's health insurance plan?
Yes.
Okay, and she has a single plan.
Yes.
Right. So she right now currently pays 15%.
So that would that be motion one?
That'd be motion number one.
Okay, I just know which one I'm not supposed to vote on.
So this is a recommendation of the treasurer collector, the town accountant, and the town administrator.
I would move to increase the, unless somebody else has something.
No, thank you, Bill. I was going to ask for a motion.
Move to increase the non-union employees' health insurance contribution to 23% on July 1, 2017, 24% July 1, 2018, 25% on July 1, 2019. And that's keeping in order that we had recommended as a Board of Selectmen group that we would like to get everybody in the town up to the 25%.
So we have a motion on the floor from Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, we got a second from Arthur. Are there any questions from the board on this motion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
And abstaining, it's Bill, you abstaining from
no,
this?
No, on the next motion.
On the next, but I'm sorry. Yeah. So that is a unanimous vote, 5-0. Now, on the suggested motion number two.
Number one.
I'm sorry, number one.
We just went backwards.
Yes, thank you. Do we have any questions on this, or is there a motion?
I move to increase early retirees, non-Medicare eligible health insurance contributions to 19% on July 1st, 2017, to 22% on July 1st, 2018, and to 25% on July 1st, 2019.
It's a motion by Matthew. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Dan. Any questions? All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Present not voting because I would have a conflict of interest.
Bill is abstaining, so the vote would be four for and one abstaining. Motion passes.
So, Mr. Chairman, I just want to make sure the public knows that we have discussed this previously. This is not the first time that we've looked at this. We had a discussion with it, and this board directed town administrator to reach out to the folks that this would impact to make sure that this is not a surprise to anyone. I'm certain they're not appreciative of it, but it's a position that the town is in financially that led us to this, and also as Bill mentioned, to bring everyone in an even course of 25% is a goal of the Board of Selectmen. So this does affect a lot of people, and we take it very seriously, but we have thought about it for several weeks now before taking this vote.
Thank you, Dan, for that explanation. I can just add that we've also completed negotiations with a couple of our unions, and they will be at 25% at the end of their three-year contract as well. And as Dan said, that's been the goal of this board, and there's been much discussion about it, pro and con, but we believe this is the right thing to do. We need to approve the minutes of March 27th.
Move approval of the minutes of March 27th, 2017.
Second.
Motion by Arthur, second by Matthew. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
And I'll abstain from that as I was absent from that meeting. So the vote is 4-0. Under old business, does anyone have anything to bring up? The town administrator's report?
Quick one, Mr. Chairman. I attended a meeting that was called by one of our fellow town managers, and the meeting was at the South Shore Chamber of Commerce headquarters in Rockland, and the discussion was over housing on the South Shore, and some of the communities that were represented were talking about some of the projects and programs that they have in their communities, and ironically it centered around mixed-use development, on how towns in Marshfield, Norwell, Cohasset are all looking at trying to bolster their downtowns by having mixed-use developments. And I thought it was ironic when I mentioned to the group that we had a bylaw that's at the annual town meeting that will revise the current zoning bylaws in the Center Protection District, which would eliminate mixed-use development in the center of town. So I know that Peter Foreman, who's the chief executive officer of the South Shore Chamber of Commerce, had offered to write a letter in support of the keeping the bylaw as it currently exists for mixed-use development. I told Peter that I'd be happy to get back to him in the immediate future, but it was kind of ironic that that these communities were talking about how best to rejuvenate their town, downtowns and their central business districts by having residential uses combined with commercial uses, and that's occurring in Marshfield and in Norwell. It's an attempt at that, and then of course in Cohasset as well. And so that was a very informative couple hours that I spent there, and I just thought it was kind of ironic that our planning board is now looking at eliminating mixed use in in the Center Protection District, which is in essence the Pembroke Center zoning area. So anyway, that's my report.
Now the planning board will have an article on the warrant for that.
They do.
Mm-hmm. So
the two articles that they have are to eliminate mixed use development and then in the Center Protection District. So either it would be, well, in essence it would be all commercial, and then the second article that they have is to eliminate the size of the Center Protection District zone to limit it to 300 feet from the curb going back. Right now the bylaw allows for 300 feet or the size of the parcel, whichever is greater, so that if you have a parcel that's 600 feet deep, then that district would pertain to that entire district. The entire parcel, as opposed to a line going through the middle of that parcel where the first 300 feet would be Center Protection and the second 300 feet would be whatever zone is behind it, probably residential A. So those are the two that are being proposed by the planning board. Although now we've been told that there's a possibility of having an amendment made at town meeting floor by the planning board, and we're not sure exactly what that amendment would be.
There's an issue with splitting zones in a lot.
Mm-hmm.
That I'm sure they're looking at themselves and hopefully seeking counsel as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because the opposition's counsel is the one that brought up that,
mm-hmm.
That very question.
Right. That's it, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Ed? Does anyone have anything for Ask the Selectmen?
Bill? I do, Mr. Chairman. I was approached by a resident of Pembroke, Gary Gumbright of Orchard Drive, Pembroke, and he said that he was in Weymouth at the town hall, and he observed a sign in Weymouth that, you can see it says reserved for veterans parking. If you guys have seen that before, I mentioned it last week when I was here. It wouldn't have the Weymouth insignia on it, actually it had Pembroke's. We thought that was a pretty good idea, so I would like to get a vote by the selectmen to have this approved so that we could order the sign or signs and make a place out in our parking lot for veterans, seeing we have a veterans agent here and they do come to visit. It would only be right that we take care of the veterans. So
Has anyone come up with where the sign would be, or?
Nope. I think I'd probably talk to the building inspector and the agent, and take their recommendation and put it out there. Also contacted the DPW director, Mr. Fullmine, and he received a quote for the sign. The resident said that he would be willing to pay for the sign to implement the project, and I just think it's a pretty good idea. So if anybody has any other questions, or
any questions for Bill?
What would be the requirement that you have veterans plates?
I don't think there's any requirement. I mean, I'm a veteran, but I don't have veterans plates.
Right.
Commercial plates on my truck. But if I saw that spot open and I was a veteran, I would assume that you'd be able to use it. So the enforceability of it, who knows? It's like, you know, a mother that's pregnant or something. When you go to the shopping store, it's who really enforces all those signs? I don't really know, but it's most people, if they see the sign, they would abide by it.
We'll call it on the honor system.
Yeah.
Well, we do that with the visitor parking spaces that we have in the front of town hall anyway.
Yeah. So any other questions for Bill, or do I have a motion?
No, I think it's a nice idea.
I would move that we authorize Mr. Fullmine to order a sign or signs and talk to the building department and the veterans agent to see what would be a good location outside of the town hall to post that for veterans parking. So.
Motion by Bill.
Second.
Is there a second? Second by Arthur. All those in favor of Bill's motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, that's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. New business. Anyone have anything under new business? I had one thing I wanted to inform the board, that we are having such good progress being made on the solar farm out at the recycling center, and what that's going to mean revenue-wise to the town, that I'll be working with Mr. Thorne to look at other properties in the town that may or may not qualify for a second solar farm. And we'll be looking. We've already had discussion. We haven't made any field trips yet, but we're going to be discussing that, and I will keep the board informed of our progress.
Mr. Chairman, can I make a comment on that?
Yes, Matthew.
I think we should keep an open mind towards a, might sound ambitious, but a hydroelectric or a hydro turbine in the North River, if that's a possibility.
Well, I'm not the expert on water, so I will turn to our expert.
I'll tell you, the tide runs twice a day. So I'm sure that, you know, may be an option, that as long as it was low enough that no boats would interfere with it or whatever. It's probably a possibility to look into that.
I think we should do that.
Would you like to take that assignment on?
Sure.
That would be excellent. I think that would be a good idea. Thank you, Matthew. So we'll put that down.
Get ready for some red tape.
Upcoming issues on April 3rd, a review and vote recommendations to the warrant articles. Also on April 3rd, a planning board public hearing will be held on the Selectmen's zoning article regarding marijuana. On April 10th, a final review and recommendations on warrant articles. April 24th, sign the annual and the special within the annual town meeting. And we have a need this evening for our executive session, Mr. Thorne.
Yes, sir. Can I just say one thing before we go into executive session?
Certainly.
I was contacted by the Boston Globe to write a small article on my comments in regards to the implementation of marijuana pot shops in Pembroke, and I did so do that and gave my opinion as a resident of Pembroke and a member of the Pembroke Board of Selectmen, just so that you know that, so that, so I don't know when the article was coming out, but...
It'll be the Boston Globe, did you say?
Yeah, I think it's Boston Globe South.
Yeah, John Mather.
Yes.
It's on Sundays. Comes out Sunday, the Globe South.
So,
well, we'll look for that. I look at it every week.
So it'll probably be next week.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Do we also have a need, Mr. Thorne, to come back into regular session for a vote?
Yes, sir.
We will.
Yes.
Okay. So there is a need for executive session, and when it's over, we will return in public session to take a vote. Can I have a motion for executive session?
Move to go into executive session.
To...
Okay.
Oh, sorry.
That's right.
Move to go into executive session under Mass General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation if an opening meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigation position of the public body and the chair so declares. This would be for clerical, DPW, police, fire, and police superior officers union. And six, to consider the value of real estate off Monroe Street.
And the chair so declares.
Second.
Okay. Motion by Bill, second by Dan. Dan?
Yes.
Matthew?
Yes.
Bill?
Yes.
Arthur?
Yes.
And I vote yes. The next regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Selectmen is April 3rd, 2017 at 7 p.m. Thank you. Welcome back. We're back in public session after executive session, and we're ready to have a vote. Can I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, the first motion that I would like to make would be in regard to the Town of Pembroke and AFSCME Council 93 Local 1700, the Public Works Unit. And I would like to make a motion to approve as written and bargained by the Board of Selectmen and the Town's Attorney.
Second.
Motion by Bill and a second by Dan. All those in favor?
Aye.
Please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Arthur is opposing, so that would be four in favor and one against.
The second vote that needs to be taken is the Town of Pembroke and AFSCME Council 93, Local 1700, the Clerical Union. And I would like to approve as written and bargained by the Board of Selectmen and the Town's Attorney.
Second.
Motion by Bill and a second by Dan. Any comments? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none. That's unanimous. I would just like to say to the public that we've just voted to approve three-year contracts for the Clerical Union and the DPW employees. So that's it for tonight, and the next meeting will be a week from tonight on the 3rd of April at 7 o'clock.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion to adjourn by Dan, second by Bill. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you next Monday evening.